Welcome to Concepts of Programming Languages. In this video, I want to talk about evaluation errors, evaluating expressions and that it can potentially go wrong. Expressions in which evaluation has side effects and short circuit evaluation. So let's get started. So recall from a previous video that we had defined a grammar for expressions. Here you see the Boolean expressions that consist of, say, variables, constants, a unary operator for negation, testing the equality between two expressions, conjunction, disjunction, exclusive disjunction. And we also introduced integer expressions, consisting of variables, constants, unary negation, equality, addition, multiplication, and subtraction. Now, also mixed expressions were introduced where all these operators are thrown on one big pile. And there we additionally introduced the conditional expression, casting expressions that you see over here. So the notion of overloading was also introduced, but let me recap it. Overloading is the concept where you have used the same syntax for expressing an operation, while its meaning depends on the context. So for instance, here you see the equality operator that tests whether the two expressions are equal, but this symbol is overloaded whenever you test the integer expression equality. So from the symbol of the equality, you cannot know without looking in the context what kind of equality test that you intend to perform. Furthermore, the notion of explicit and implicit casting can be understood. Namely, whenever you try to understand expressions to which data type they belong, you could mix maybe expressions between different data types. So for instance, suppose you would perform an addition where one of its arguments to the operator would be a Boolean, then you cannot add a Boolean, so you have to cast, either explicitly or implicitly, the Boolean expression to an integer expression. In a later video in this course, we will also look at type checking for performing statically checks on how to understand whether expressions built up are properly typed. Also there, we will see again casting. Okay, so let's continue now with more advanced notions of expressions and their evaluation. So whenever you perform evaluation in, say, an implementation of a programming language, certain errors could occur. As you have seen in a previous video, we had the notion of indirect variables, so that are variables that not themselves directly contain a value in a state, but instead contain as a value an address at the memory location where we can find the value of the variable indirectly, and there is a special address value, namely the null pointer. The null pointer points to no valid address, so there cannot be found any value. Whenever you then want to evaluate what is the value stored at a particular address, but you want to do that for the null pointer, then an error occurs. And this is typically called a null pointer dereferencing error. Further errors could also occur whenever you are evaluating expressions. For instance, in integer expressions where there is an operator for division, you could, for instance, divide by zero. And this is an undefined value. Depending on the programming language, these errors are handled in a different manner. And you could imagine that a division by zero could be resolved in some programming languages by giving back a default value or by using a special value that signifies not a number, or you could raise a certain kind of exception that then can later be handled, or you crash the program or even the machine. different kinds of solutions to this practical problem. An important class of, you could call them errors, are overflows, and they typically occur whenever you deal with integers. Overflows can be best explained by an example, I suppose. So I will here talk about implicit overflows, which means that whenever an integer overflow occurs, we do not raise an error or crash the program, but instead implicitly handle its behavior. There are also explicit overflows. Some programming languages offer this, where the error has to be treated explicitly or has to be handled explicitly. Anyway, let's continue with implicit overflow behavior. Consider the finite data type of unsigned integers that can be represented in an 8-bit value or an 8-bit register. They have only 2 to the power 8 different values in this data type. So let's say 0 until 255, including. Then, now you could try to understand what is an overflow. Well, consider the addition of two values. Let's say we add the value 250 to the value 5. Well, in this case, the resulting value 255 is representable in the data type. So this operation is well defined. But what happens if we add 250 to the value 6? Both are values of our data type, namely 250 is a value and 6 is a value, but 256 is not a value anymore. So what then happens, and this is called an overflow, a different value is then chosen because the real value or the actual result of the operation cannot be expressed within the limited finite data type. And you could understand this properly if you know about modular or modulo arithmetic. Now, suppose we want to add 7 to 250. It is almost as if the clock from 11 goes back to 0, or whenever you drive a car and then your kilometer counter then reaches 9999, and then it flows over, as it is called, back to 0000. And then you can keep on counting from the start again. Okay, so you could then indeed see that, say, 250 plus 8 then becomes 4, which is representable in the data type. Now consider that you also have, for instance, the signed integers that can be represented by 8-bit. Still, there are 2 to the power 8 different values in this data type, namely minus 128 until 127 positive. And then you can also see that there an overflow could occur. But how would this be resolved then? Suppose that you have the value 120 and 7. These are both values in our data type, and we add them, and then we get the value 127. This is a value that can be represented in the data type. But what happens if we want to add 120 and 8? There is no value 128 in the data type. So also here, it flows over and it goes back to the minimal value, so to say. And this is a particular consequence of the bit representation of integers. In the previous video, you could have clicked the link on signed integer representations and you would find more information about, for instance, 2's and 1's complement, a particular implementation of how to represent integers in a bit field. Commonly implemented by digital computers. Now consider that this overflow could also occur for different kinds of values. Okay, so 120 plus 10 equals minus 126. Okay, but now consider the following. You could also have the unary minus operator. So 127 is clearly a value that can be represented by an 8-bit signed integer. And whenever we take the minus of that, well, then we get also a value that can be represented by an 8-bit signed integer. But what happens if we take as a value a minus 128, and then we want to take the minus of that? And in this case, we have the value minus 128, but now we want to take the unary minus operation on that. But the 128, as we already have seen before, could not be represented, and instead is represented as minus 128 itself by this overflow mechanism. So, weirdly enough, taking the minus of a minus number results in a negative number. So this shows to you that in the implementation of arithmetical operations on a machine with finite memory, you could turn into certain surprises, such as that negation is not involutive, that the negation of a negation is not necessarily the same. So imagine that the typical law minus of minus x equals x, well, it is violated, as you can see here. Okay, let's continue with side effectful expressions. So the evaluation function that we have seen up to now was an evaluation function that takes a particular state in which variables are assigned values, and then given in a denotational style, this evaluation function can be defined. But now in many imperative programming languages, it is also possible in expressions to cause effects. And this could mean that the state is updated while you are evaluating expressions. So in other words, expressions with side effects or side effectful expressions modify the state during its evaluation. Now, you could imagine also the opposite of side effectful expressions. I'll come back to that later. So what are examples what are examples of operators that have a side effect? You could imagine that there is a post-increment expression. So a post-increment expression is an expression that takes a variable and then says, the meaning of this post-increment operator is that it takes the value as it was originally in the state, but furthermore, as a side effect, has that the value is increased by one. And there is also the opposite. This is the pre-increment expression. This means that you take the variable's value, you first increase, also by causing an effect on the state, the value by one, and then that is the value of the overall expression, so the expression that that is, consists of this pre-increment and a variable. Now, where did the side effectful expressions come from? Well, it as often in computer science, there was a certain let's call it optimization that was possible in the design of a certain processor. The circuitry of the processor made it possible in the execution of instructions to also cause a certain effect. So then these low-level details of the machine got exposed in the programming language. So that's why we have to deal with these side effectful expressions. And most languages allow them. Another interesting side effectful expression, if you have them anyway, causes an arbitrary assignment. So this modifies the state, not just with respect to a particular variable that you want to pre or post increment, but you can assign in an expression an arbitrary variable. Especially in, for instance, the C programming language, this is useful because then you could, for instance, in the test of a while command, also perform an assignment that makes sense in the body of the while loop. So If you have side effectful expressions and you have operators, then it is important to know what is the order in which the arguments to operators are evaluated. Since these sub-expression evaluations can cause effects, you want to know which effects happen in what order. So this is typically called an evaluation order, which determines which of the sub-expressions or the arguments to an operator are evaluated first, second, third, etc. So here, let's see an example. Suppose that initially in our state, the variable x is assigned the value 10, the integer value 10. Now, the post-increment expression would look like this. So we have a variable x immediately followed by a double plus sign. So this itself then is a post-increment expression. The intended meaning of the post-increment expression is that the value of this expression is the original value that was stored in the state of variable x. But furthermore, it causes as a side effect that the value that was stored at x is now incremented by 1. Similarly, this is a pre-increment expression. It is written by the plus plus symbol on before as a prefix to the variable x. This has as intended meaning that the value of this expression is determined by first modifying the state by incrementing the variable x, and then the new value, so where x has been incremented, it then becomes also the value of this pre-increment expression. And an example of an assignment expression looks like this. So here you see an assignment. You have typically seen these before as commands, but now it is turned into an expression. So that means that these assignments could in a side-effectful expression occur anywhere where there could be an expression. The evaluation of an assignment has the following meaning. You first evaluate whatever the variable should be assigned to. Then it causes an update to the state that the variable as named on the left-hand side gets this new value. And then the overall value of the expression is the same value as that was assigned. Okay, let's consider a number of examples. So here is quite a complicated example, and you might remember it from our previous video where we talked about greedy parsers, but now let's consider giving it a meaning. So for that, I just put some parentheses around it so you can recognize what are the expressions. So on the top level of the expression, we have an addition operator, the plus symbol. And then we have on the left-hand side, x plus plus. So this is a post-increment expression of the variable x. And on the right-hand side, we have plus plus x, which is a pre-increment expression on the variable x. Now, let's say that the evaluation order of operators is going from the left to the right. So we first evaluate the argument of the plus on the left, and then we evaluate the argument on the right. Okay, so how would that then work? Well, suppose x has the value 10. If we want to determine the value of this expression, then we first have to evaluate what is the value of the left sub-expression. Well, the value of the left sub-expression, since x has the value 10, this becomes the value of the post-increment expression. But furthermore, the state is updated. So now, after this has the value 10, we also know that the state has been changed and x has the value 11. So then we consider the right-hand side, and the right-hand side first increments the variable x. So that causes the variable x to have the value 12. And then that value is then the value of the pre-increment expression. So then we have 10 plus 12, which is 22. Another example where we also combine the assignment expression would be this. Now you could try to think for yourself what is the value and pause the video, but let me explain it right now. So what do we do? Well, we have again a plus on the top level, and we first evaluate the left-hand side. The left-hand side is an assignment expression, so we first have to evaluate the expression on the right-hand side. The expression on the right-hand side is a post-increment expression, so this gets the original value of x, so let's say initially it had value 10, so this also has value 10, and causes furthermore the state to be updated to set x to 11, incrementing it by 1. But then this value is 10, and that value 10 is then again assigned to x. So x is restored to have the value 10 again. And the assignment expression now gets the same value as that the expression had on the right-hand side. So this one gets the value 10. And now still the value of x, or still, again, the value of x is 10. So then we evaluate the right-hand side of the plus symbol. In this case, we get plus plus x. So we increment the value of x to become 11, and that is the value of the right-hand side. So then the result of this expression would be 10 plus 11, making 21. Okay, let's continue. If you have an expression, a side-effectful expression, it is possible, in an imperative programming language at least, to eliminate such expressions from the program by introducing additional commands around the occurrence of the side-effectful expression. And so if you have a program in which side-effectful expressions appear, in an imperative programming language, it is possible to replace all the expressions step by step, including new commands surrounding the original expression that then causes the elimination of the side effectful expressions. And then we end up with expressions that are not side affecting. So this is what I wanted to say before, namely, on the one hand, you have side-effectful expressions, and on the other hand, you have the side-effect-free expressions, so expressions that do not modify the state. These side-effect-free expressions are also called pure expressions. So to see an example how to eliminate, let's consider the example we had before, but now in the context of the following program. Let's say we declare variable x with initially a value 10, and then afterwards we declare variable y, which has as an initial value the following expression. And we previously determined that this value had to be 22. So how can we now eliminate this side-effectful expression from the program? Well, I'll give you immediately the outcome of it and explain how it is obtained. So originally we had this variable declaration x here. Well, that one remains. But now instead of this declaration where we had a side effect full expression, we now get this chunk of program. So where we used to have y, we now end up with y equals z1 plus z2. And these z1 and z2 are fresh variables. And by that I mean you pluck out a name that is not yet used in the program and you insert additional commands and declarations for such variables. So in this case, these new text elements are introduced before we do the declaration of y. And what does this one encode? It encodes the side-effectful expression, but in terms of assignments. And these are assignment commands. Okay, so we have x is 10. And now in a temporary variable, as it is also called, this fresh variable z1, a temporary variable, we assign the original value of x. And then we perform an update of the state by the assignment expression by saying x becomes x plus 1. So after this point, we know x is 11. Next, we, in a temporary variable z2, put in the value x plus 1. And we know that x was 11 before, so this gets the value 12. And furthermore, we then perform the update of the state by saying x now becomes 12 as well. So then, whenever we then evaluate y's expression, it refers to z1 and z2, and this is a pure expression, because these are just variables that it refers to. And z1 refers to now the left-hand side of the plus, sub-expression evaluation, which had the original value of 10. And z2 now refers to the right-hand side of the original side-effectful expression, but which now has the value 12. So therefore, now y gets assigned 10 plus 12, which is 22. So this shows you an example how to eliminate side-effectful expressions. So that gives you the idea that you can also always program a programming language in which only pure expressions are present. Because every side effectful expression, at least in an imperative programming language, can be eliminated by introducing temporary variables. Okay, so let's continue. An interesting aspect of side effectful evaluation, or you could say orthogonal to side effectful evaluation, is a special kind of evaluation of the Boolean expressions, and this is called short circuit evaluation. So just like side effectful expressions are a different, more advanced way of evaluating expressions because they can cause as a side effect updates to the state, short circuit evaluation can also be considered an advanced form of evaluation, because in short circuit evaluation it's not necessary to obtain the value of all sub expressions to determine the value of overall outer expressions. To illustrate this, I will do that for Boolean expressions, but for that I introduce additional operators which represent this short circuit evaluations in most imperative languages. So let's consider the two additional Boolean operators. It's short circuit conjunction, so that's a double ampersand, and short circuit disjunction, which is a double bar. Now, to give you an example what the meaning is of these double ampersands and double bars, this short circuit conjunction and short circuit disjunction, let me just throw you in the deep and give you some concrete examples. So consider that x is an indirect variable, so a pointer to some memory location where a value is stored, and let's say y is an integer variable, so y directly stores an integer. You could then think, if x is an indirect variable, what I mentioned earlier in this video about the null dereferencing. This is an evaluation error. But what if you want to avoid dereferencing null? Well, for that case, you can make use of the short circuit conjunction. Here you see an example, or disjunction, sorry. So here you see an example. It's a Boolean expression where on the left hand side of the short circuit disjunction you have the test that checks whether the x address is the null pointer or not. And if this is true, then the overall expression becomes true, and it no longer has to consider the right-hand side of the short circuit disjunction. And so it's basically a lazy evaluation because it does not have to evaluate all its sub-expression to determine the overall result, the resulting value of the expression. So if the left-hand side is true, then because a disjunction is true if either the left or the right one is true, we start at the left-hand side of the operator, and if it's already true, we are done. We don't even have to look at evaluating the right-hand side. Well, and that is a good case, because suppose indeed that x is null, then if we were to evaluate the right-hand side with x now being null, then we got a dereferencing error here, because x is the null pointer. If we want to obtain access through through the pointer to some record that is stored in memory, that would then result in an evaluation error. But since this right side of the disjunction is never evaluated, we avoid the error happening in the first place. Another example would be with, for instance, the division by zero. Consider this expression. The left-hand side of the short circuit conjunction is a test that checks whether y is not equal to zero. And if that is then the case, to make the conjunction true, both the left and the right-hand side have to be true. So if it is the case that y is not equal to zero, only then we start evaluating the right-hand side. And in the right-hand side, we perform a division by y. So it is very useful to know that y is not equal to zero, because that would cause an evaluation error. And so if it is the case that y is not equal to zero, then we evaluate the test on the right-hand side. And in that case, well, when will it be true? Well, if 10 divided by y equals 5, y has to be 2. So indeed, whenever y is not equal to 0, 2 is not equal to 0, then the left-hand side is true and the right-hand side is true, and then the overall expression is true. But now, what if y is 0? So suppose y is 0. Well, if we then would evaluate this short circuit conjunction, we only evaluate the left-hand side, which will be false, because 0, not equal to 0 itself, is false. Hè? 0 is equal to 0, so 0 not equal to 0 is false. So since the left-hand side then is false, then we can immediately know what the resulting Boolean expression has as a value. It's also false, and we don't have to evaluate the right-hand side. Okay, so that saves us this division by zero error. Okay, now short circuit evaluation in this case shows you how it's nicely combined whenever evaluation errors could occur. But on the other hand, short circuit evaluation is also nicely combined whenever you have side effectful expressions. Consider that these expressions here are all not side effectful. So these are all pure expressions. They do not cause a state change whenever they are evaluated. But here you have a side effectful expression that occurs. So here it is also nice that these short circuit operators determine the order in which the sub-expressions are evaluated. It is always the case that the left hand must be evaluated first, and only then, whenever it's true, in the case of conjunction, the right hand side is evaluated. So in this case, let's suppose that it is true that y plus plus equals 10. Well, then y had the value 10, but because of the side effectful sub-expression y plus plus here, y now after evaluation of this test must have the value 11. So then whenever we evaluate the test on the right, indeed it is the case that y is 11. Now consider the difference between the short circuit operation, sort of the short circuit Boolean operation, and the operation where we have just a single conjunction. In the case of a single conjunction in some programming languages, the order of evaluation is not specified. So that means that the programming language implementation, so say the compiler or the interpreter of a program, may arbitrarily choose or even in parallel evaluate the expressions. Well, and in that case, what do you have to do whenever the one on the left causes a side effect on the state? So it is then important to understand that in some programming languages, the combination of side effects with certain operators might get tricky. And technically, if you want to know more about this, for instance, in the C language, you can speak of so-called sequence points that determine at what point it becomes sensible to read out the value of previously evaluated side effectful expression. In this case, you could argue, okay, so in the ampersand, we evaluate the two expressions in the original state. So let's say that originally y has the value 10, then y plus plus equals 10 is true on the left, and then causes an update, but that update is not yet visible to the right. So the right expression, y equals 11, is also evaluated in the original state, so where y was 10, and 10 is not equal to 11. So this would then be false, whereas this would be true, so the overall expression then would be false. And only after the whole expression has been evaluated, or until the next sequence point is obtained, then afterwards any observation of the variable y would result in seeing the result of this side effect. Okay, but if this is a little bit too much, don't worry, it's an advanced topic, this sequence point. That you might be interested in studying it. Okay. I now want to talk a little bit about the consequences of this short circuit or side effectful evaluation. So you could imagine that the expressions we up to now have seen made sense from a mathematical perspective, in the sense that you could understand these expressions as if they would be expressions as you write down them in mathematics. But whenever we involve these advanced concepts, such as side-effectful expressions or short-circuit evaluations, no longer you can apply mathematical reasoning to understand what the value is of expressions. And I will show you that by two examples. So the first example is an equivalence that holds for the usual Boolean, expressions. So the simple Boolean expressions as previously seen, so without considering the side effects or short circuit evaluation. So now, if you indeed add side effects or short circuit evaluation, then you can ask yourself the question, does this equation, does this equivalent, still hold? Because this is true for Boolean expressions in, say, a Boolean algebra. But is this still the case whenever we have side effects or short circuit evaluation? Well, then consider the following. Take for B the side effectful expression x plus plus, so that is the post-increment operator, smaller than 5. And so x plus plus is the post-increment operator, and then we have the relation smaller than and then the constant 5. Now, when is this B true? Think of that. Well, in any state where originally the value of x is smaller than 5, because the post-increment expression will have as a value the original value of 5, but furthermore causes a side effect on the state. So whenever x is indeed smaller than 5, well, then this expression will be true. So if the single standing expression b is true whenever x is smaller than 5, is it then also the case that if we take the conjunction, that then the result is also true? Well, this now depends on the order in which these Boolean expressions are evaluated. What I've told you previously about sequence points determines the answer to this question. So suppose we indeed have this advanced notion of sequence points, then both B and B would be evaluated in the same original state, but both would cause an update to the state that might conflict. Well, in this case, they result in the same value. And then you could argue that this still holds. But now suppose to just demonstrate the complexity of this subject with side effect full expressions, that the single conjunction first evaluates the expression, say, on the left, and then all the effects are then visible to the expression on the right. Well, in that case, the equivalence no longer is true, because you could take x to be equal to 4 and then evaluate this conjunction where we have explicit order. Well, the first one, b, would be true, but it causes the state of x to be updated, and that is visible whenever we evaluate the second time b. Because whenever x is 4 and then we do the post-increment, that causes x to become 5. And 5 is not smaller than 5, so the right-hand side then would be false. So what can we then now say about short-circuit evaluation? No longer our intuition, for instance, when reasoning about Boolean expressions, as say in Boolean algebra, holds. You have, for instance, the law of distribution, the distributivity law, in which a conjunction can be distributed, or sorry, in which a disjunction can be distributed over a conjunction. Right? It is as if we push this disjunction down underneath the conjunction. Now, what is then now the problem whenever you have short circuit evaluation? Now, consider two possibilities. Consider is it the equivalence is true whenever in every state the expression on the left has the same value as the expression on the right. But is this the case? Is in every state the expression on the left of the same value as the expression on the right? Well, let's analyze that. So suppose in this given state that B1 and B2 are evaluated to false. Then if we look at the expression on the left of the equivalence, We can see that since B1 and B2 are false, whenever we first evaluate B1, and that's false, then the result is entirely false. Oh, there may be a mistake on the slide. On the right-hand side, whenever B1 is false, we continue with the evaluation of B2. So whenever B2 then is true, then the result here is true, and we can continue with evaluating B1, which is false. But then when B3 is true, then the overall conjunction becomes true. So although B1 is false, we still get the opportunity evaluating B2 and B3. And then it is the case that if B1 is false, but B2 and B3 are true, then the expression on the right is true. But if it is the case that B1 is false, then without even looking at B2 or B3, the expression on the left immediately becomes false and can never become true. So please disregard what is written here. This is incorrect. Well, there you can see then that these Boolean equivalences as usually hold in a Boolean algebra no longer hold whenever you have this advanced notion of short circuit evaluation. Okay, so that concludes this video. Thank you for watching, and I hope to see you soon again.